Okay, so we want to basically study a little closer sections of vector bundles. On one hand, we'll need that later on because we want to talk about vector fields in the Lie group context. However, as I said, sort of the second piece of how you build a canonical manifolds of mappings is we need to study vector fields attached to a given smooth function, and this can very conveniently be formulated as sections into a certain vector bundle. So let's recall what was again a vector bundle, and this is quite a mouthful, but it's mostly language. So recall that a vector bundle with typical fiber F. And in our case, we don't require that the fiber is a finite dimensional space, so it might be a locally convex space. It's basically a pair of manifolds together with a submersion. So one of the manifolds is called the total space, and the other one is base space, or the just the base. And we have the submersion. However, we are requiring that that for every point, there's an open neighborhood of the point together with a diffeomorphism trivializing the bundle, meaning that we can split. See that this total space is always is locally over this manifold over this open subset UX is is diffeomorphic to UX times the fiber, and so this bundle trivialization should satisfy several things. On one hand, it acts as it acts almost as a submersion chart. So if we compose our submersion with this bundle trivialization, then we get just the projection onto the first component. And at least from the vector bundle type point of view, even more important condition is if we fix a point Y in this UX, then we get a smooth smooth mapping from F, so our locally convex space, to the fiber. So to what do I mean by fiber? It's just the pre-image over one point with respect to the submersion. This is what I call the fiber here. And this mapping should be a vector space isomorphism, right? So what we basically want in a vector bundle, and this is also the typical picture, we basically want to be able to write this total space as open subset of M times the fiber. At least locally we want to do this, and the fibers should all be locally convex spaces, or at least vector spaces. Okay, let's look at the usual examples. This is sort of the setting another bit of notation. So we also write EX as the pre-image of X under this under the submersion. This is the fiber, and it carries a canonical locally convex vector space structure just by the definition. Okay, and now we can, of course, if we have a manifold F vector space or locally convex space, actually I should have said, then we can form the trivial bundle. This is just you take the manifold times the vector space, and the projection onto the first component is then a submersion, and this is called the trivial bundle. That's not very exciting. A little bit more exciting of a thing we have already seen is the tangent bundle. So we have seen in an earlier lecture that the tangent bundle comes with a submersion, just the base point projection. And we had the typical charts for the tangent bundle. So if phi, u phi is, u phi is a chart. Of M. Then we have the T phi, and this goes from T U phi. And what we had seen is that this trivializes the neighborhood as the following. So we can what the result of this will be, it's U phi times the model space. Let's call this model, I don't know, it was not E, we've already used E. let's call the model space as one would with the fiber, let's call it F, right? So this is something we have seen in the definition. And if we take the inverse of this one, then we have it in the right direction. So this will then be a bundle trivialization of our bundle. Okay, so tangent bundles are vector bundles. And now our interest goes in the direction we want to understand sections of these vector bundles as locally convex spaces. And for a vector bundle, a smooth map from the base into the total space is called a smooth section if, when we compose it with the submersion giving us the structure of the bundle, we get the identity on the manifold M. And then since every fiber of our vector bundle is a vector space, we can pointwise add these sections. So we get a vector space of sections, which we will in the following denote by gamma of E. So we the full notation would be gamma of, then we should write the bundle. So probably something like P going from E to M, but with abuse of notation. So if we have the total space, then it's usually understood what the submersion and the base space should be. And to just shorten the notation, we have gamma of E, and those are just all sections. So smooth mappings from the base space with values in the total space, which after projection down with the bundle map P, gives us the identity. And okay, so our aim will now be to topologize these spaces of sections. I mean, we have a natural vector space structure on these vector spaces. However, it's not clear at the moment how they become a locally convex space. I mean, if they are sitting inside of a topological space, so they're sitting inside of the C-infinity functions, and we can topologize the C-infinity functions with a compact open C-infinity topology. However, I mean, and obviously the sections then inherit a subspace topology. However, it's not clear a priori that this subspace topology will turn the sections into a locally convex space. You can actually prove that this is true. We'll take a slightly different sneaky route getting around this problem. We will introduce another way to topologize this vector space of sections. And what you can prove, but this is a lot of nitty-gritty details and work which we don't want to invest. You can prove that this other way of topologizing the sections we are taking now actually leads to the same topology you would get from the subspace topology of the C-infinity functions. However, the advantage of topologizing it in a different way will be that it is completely obvious why the topology turns the space of section into a locally convex space. And that's what we are really after, because spaces of suitable sections will be our model spaces for our manifolds of mappings. Okay, so let's see how this goes about. Okay, another example. So you might have seen vector fields. So if we take the tangent bundle, as we already know that this is a vector bundle, and then the sections are better known as, well, in this case, smooth vector fields. And to emphasize this, instead of writing sections of the tangent bundle, usually I will write sort of this calligraphic V of M, so V for vector fields. So those are all the vector fields on M. Okay. I mean, if you've seen vector fields, then you probably will also have seen this bundle formalism. So vector fields are just a special kind of sections of bundles for the bundle being the tangent bundle. Okay, but now let's see. Let's first define what is the principal part of a section. And note that I now for convenience sort of have flipped around. So before we were writing bundle trivializations, which are going from UI times F with values in the pre-image of UI. Since it's a diffeomorphism, it's sometimes a bit fishy what you call a bundle trivialization. Is it the mapping going from UI times F into this thing or conversely? And here I just flipped the convention. So in terms of our definition of the bundle, this should be kappa I inverse. But okay, let's not get bogged down with these. So let's say we have a vector bundle with a typical fiber F and a bundle trivialization or a bunch of bundle trivialization covering E. So what do I mean by covering E? I want that the domains of these bundle trivializations cover the total space. And by the way, this is set up. This is the same as requiring that the UI are covering the M, because we have here a sub. We have so the P here is a. Is a surjective submersion from E to M. Okay, so covering so these inverse images here will be covering the E if the UI are covering the M. But okay, so we take a bunch of bundle trivialization. Let us define the principal part of a section, and you might have seen this also in the vector space case already for vector fields. And the principal part of a section X in the trivialization kappa is kappa I is defined as X kappa I. So this is, you take the section, you compose it with the bundle with the bundle trivialization, and you want and then you compose it with the projection onto the fiber F. So basically, what is happening? So I take a section M, X from M to E. Recall, if I go back here using the P, so the P composed with X is the identity on M. And so in here, in the M, I have this open set UI, I have P inverse of UI, and I restrict the X to this open set. So this is an open set up here. Then I take the kappa I. I go to UI times F. Then I take the projection onto F. So I end up here in F. And this mapping I get after the composition of these things, I call X kappa I. So what is happening here? When we look at the X inside of this bundle trivialization, we see because the bundle trivialization is conjugating this submersion P to the projection onto the first component. So what we see is what is the result if we take if we take kappa I, if we take kappa I and compose it with X at a point where this makes sense, so then we see here we get the identity on UI and then a smooth map in the second component, which is exactly this X kappa I, right? So basically a section, because if we project it down using the bundle projection, we get the identity, does not do anything in the first component. So we have just the identity and the principal part. So where the section is allowed to do something interesting. So this principal part is just defined as we compose it with kappa I, and then afterwards with the projection onto the relevant part. And these principal parts is what we want to study. This is actually where the sections are doing something. Okay, so this is the principal part. And okay, so here we have the formula now in NICE. Right. And we use these principal parts to declare a topology on the space of all sections. So remember, we have so the UI, they cover our manifold M, and we define a map, which is which I call now IE. And this is a map which takes sections and maps them into a product of spaces of the form C infinity from UI with values in the fiber. So this is a locally convex space, the fiber, and we are just sending the X to the family of its principal parts. And as you might imagine, if you have done such a construction, you can always recover if you know all the principal parts of a vector field, you know the vector field. So you can rebuild the vector field. Section. You can if you know the principal part of the section, then you can reconstruct the section as a global object if these principal parts all fit together. And we are what this IE is doing. It's basically resolving our section as this family of principal parts. So it's shoving it into the space of C infinity functions, and the spaces on the right hand side we let carry the compact open C infinity topology. Why is this advantageous? So the UI here is endowed with, or this is an, if you want, this is an open manifold, so an open submanifold of M. So it's an open subset of M. And we have the nice property that if we take the C infinity functions from a manifold with values in a locally convex space, we have seen that this space of smooth mappings with this compact open C infinity topology again becomes a locally convex space. So all of the pieces here on the right hand side, they are locally convex spaces. And if we take a product, even if it's an infinite one, of locally convex spaces, then with the product topology, this again becomes a locally convex space. So what happens here? We are shoving the sections into a product of locally convex spaces. So this realizes the sections as a subset of a locally convex space. And by construction, this mapping IE, because we can uniquely recover a section if we know all of its principal parts, this IE is an injective mapping. So we will use this to define a vector space and actually a locally convex space structure on the sections. Because what happens, so I said, well, what is the vector space operation on the sections? We know that the vector space operation is just pointwise addition and scalar multiplication in the fiber. So this means we are pointwise adding principal parts. Or in other words, we can think of this, the pointwise vector operation. So if I take the sum and scalar product of a section x with, or take the sum of x plus r times u, where r, x and u are both sections, r is a real number, then this can be, this commutes with this mapping IE we have here. So actually, from the point of view of abstract vector spaces, the IE is a vector space morphism or linear map. So this injective linear map relates the vector space structure on the sections with the vector space structure on the right hand side. And what we can just do is we declare, since we declared the topology on the sections as the initial topology with respect to the IE, this means that the sections become a locally convex space with this type of topology. And as I said, one can prove that this initial topology is actually or coincides with the subspace topology the sections inherit from the C infinity functions from M to E. However, this construction by shoving it into this product makes it immediately recognizable that the sections form a locally convex space with a natural topology, right? And the natural topology here is basically given by the by hacking a section apart into the family of principal parts, and then we're working with the principal parts. We have seen similar arguments, which are then called scattering arguments, in the lecture leading up to the exponential law, where we did a similar construction, but with smooth mappings, and where we partitioned sort of the space into by making the U, making the manifold, or dividing the manifold M into also smaller open pieces. Okay, so we have now our locally convex space structure, and this is a locally convex space structure on the sections. The question one should immediately ask now is, okay, we chose a family of local additions, not of local, of local trivializations, right? And this construction here depends on the chosen local trivializations, on these Kappa I, and also on the index set I. Of course, the question arises, does the topology depend on our choice of local trivialization, sorry, of bundle trivializations? And the answer is no. And this is an exercise. So if you look in the script, then it's not too hard to see that the image of this mapping IE is a closed subspace of the product on the right-hand side. And that if you choose another family of bundle trivializations and map a section to the family of principal parts, then the two topologies and also the locally convex space structures by extension are the same on the sections. So this does not depend on any choices we have made here. Okay, so now this was a small excursion to topologies on spaces of sections. Now we need to construct the bundles from which we want to take the sections, which will be useful in our construction of the manifolds of mappings. Okay. And the construction we're after is the so-called pullback bundle. So we start out with a smooth vector bundle over a manifold M. And in addition, we want another smooth mapping from some other manifold K taking values in the manifold M. And we define a new set, which we call F star E, or the pullback, or this will be the pullback of the bundle under this smooth mapping F. And we just define it as we are collecting points from our manifold K, so the X, and then we are taking the Cartesian product of the fiber of our vector bundle over the image point of the mapping F at this point X. Okay, and it turns out, and this is again an exercise because this calls for some tedious verifications. So this F star E turns out to be a submanifold of the product manifold K times E. And moreover, what you can show is, on one hand, we immediately get a vector space structure on every one of those guys, as the, this index X here is irrelevant to the manifold structures, to the vector space structure. So we can just identify this with EFX. And if we take the base point projection, so we have inside of F star, we have points which look like where we have an X here from K times some element of in the fiber of our bundle E, and sending this X to XY to just to the X, this turns the F star E into a vector bundle over our manifold K. And this is called, for obvious reasons, the pullback of E along F. So we started out with a vector bundle over the manifold M. However, pulling it back with F, we obtain a vector bundle now living over the domain of F, right? And so we've pulled back the vector bundle along F and got a new vector bundle over the domain. Okay. And so the reason why we're interested in these pullback bundles is what is a section now? So we have the F star of E, we have the base point projection, this is PF, and then we have the K here, and by definition, so this is just, so we're taking the X here times EFX. Okay, and now let's have a look at the section. So if I take a section here, so this will be given as a mapping. So if I take X, then, now we have a lot of X's here, but will be the result? So in the first component, it just needs to be the projection. So we get an X here. And in the second component, it does something. let's put this, okay, actually, let me just introduce the notation here. So this notation has not been introduced before. What is the meaning of this, or what do I want to say with this notation? We see that we get here at point X, we get something, a function value which sits in the fiber of the original bundle E over the image point under this mapping we've pulled it back with, right? So in a way, what this what a section of this pullback bundle does, so at every point of K, it singles out something which sits in the fiber over f of x, or in other words, when you think back of what we wanted to do with the local additions, this singles out a certain vector which sits attached to the value f of x. So f of x is a point inside of M. EFX is a vector space which sits over the point FX in the bundle E. And so a section of this pullback bundle is a fancy way of saying, I want a smooth map which attaches to every point of the graph of F a vector sticking out from this graph in some direction. And of course, there's no restriction of how to do this. So if we identify the sections, we obtain the following identity. So sections into this pullback bundle form a space which I want to denote in the following by C infinity KEF. So, and the meaning of this is those are all the smooth functions from K into the total space of the bundle, such that if we project it down using the bundle projection, we get our mapping F. And this space C infinity FKE, this is what we would call a section or a vector field or something like this attached to our given smooth mapping F. Okay, and the reason why we wanted this identification and why we want the pullback bundle at all, at least in this context, is that we know sections of vector bundles form locally convex spaces. So also the C infinity functions over a given smooth function form now a locally convex space because we have identified it with the space of sections. And this was the reason why we are jumping through all these hoops with the sections of these pullback bundles, because it gives a convenient description of the locally convex structure. I mean, one could also see this directly if one does, but at least with the sections, it is conceptually relatively easy to describe it once one has swallowed this concept of a pullback bundle. Since it now fits the topic of this subchapter, where we are talking about vector fields, about vector bundles and their sections, I want to describe two more constructions of how to get new vector bundles from old ones. So we've just seen the pullback bundle, and what we'll see on the next slide is a direct product of two bundles. I mean, that's relatively straightforward. And the last thing which I'm really after is the so-called Whitney sum of two bundles. And we will need this later on to describe Riemannian metrics. So this is we don't need the Whitney sum right now. And also the product of two bundles is not really needed right now. So we would only need the pullback bundle and the sections to describe our canonical manifolds of mappings. However, since this fits very well the bill, let's just go an extra mile and have a look at the product of two bundles and also at the Whitney sum. Okay, and so what is this? The product is as straightforward as you might expect. If we have two vector bundles, then we can form the direct product. So we are just taking the product manifolds of the total spaces and the product manifolds of the basis. And then you're employing a little lemma which says if you have two submersions and you take the product of the two submersions, then the result is also a submersion. So this product here becomes a vector bundle over the product manifold M times M. And as we've seen with direct products of manifolds, everything works as you expected. So the bundle, if you ask yourself, what is a bundle trivialization of the product bundle? It's just what you expect. You take two bundle trivializations of the of E1 and E2, and you take the product of the two bundle trivializations, and then you get a bundle trivialization for the product bundle. Okay, so direct products are really simple, as always. However, we need them to define the Whitney sum of two vector bundles. So let me just show you what this is. Okay, and so the Whitney sum is, on one hand, we need the diagonal mapping. So this is the mapping taking an element from M and sending it into the Cartesian product of M with itself. And well, it sends just M to the diagonal element M, M. And we define the Whitney sum of the two bundles P1 and P2 as a new bundle, which is usually denoted with this O plus. And it's just the pullback bundle of the product bundle under the diagonal map. And let me, okay, on one hand, I mean, this was a convenient way of stating, if you believe me, that the pullback bundle is bundle again, for the direct product, that was obvious, that's a bundle. And so we get now this new bundle, which is called the Whitney sum. However, before we end this section, I mean, let me just explain what you get when you run through these identifications, and let's see what this Whitney sum is. And so the intuition one should have about the Whitney sum, what is going on, is so how does the typical fiber of this Whitney sum look? So, and so P1 plus P2 inverse. So this is now a bundle over M. So this gets one M. And so what the typical fiber will be, so we take the pullback bundle. So we have to take the fiber of E1 times E2 over the element which is given by the smooth mapping, which is the diagonal element here. So we have to take the fiber over M, comma M, right? Or in other words, this is E1. We take the fiber at M and the same for E2. It's also the fiber at M. So what this Whitney sum formalizes is you take two bundles and two bundles over the same base, I must say. And in the direct product, what you get are all possibilities. So basically, the direct product collects all possibilities to combine the fibers of the two bundles. So here in the direct product, we can have all combinations, x, y, x, z, whatever points you like in M and M. So the direct product collects all possibilities to combine these two fibers, or the fibers over arbitrary points as a product. And in the Whitney sum, since we have pulled back the product bundle using the diagonal morphism, what happens, we are singling out only the products of fibers where the base point of the two fibers is exactly the same. So here in the Whitney sum, we always have the fiber of E1 at a point M times the fiber of E2 at the same point M. So the Whitney sum is basically throwing away all the possibilities to combine them and says, okay, we want to look at fibers at the same point, at the product of fibers at the same point. At the moment, it might not be clear why one should be interested in the Whitney sum. However, we will use this to explain Riemannian metrics. What is a Riemannian metric? So that will require us to take an inner product in certain fibers. And for this, we need this Whitney sum, because we want the fibers of the product to be at the same base point. And I mean, you might wonder, okay, why do we need to talk about this? I mean, we could just have taken the set of all the Cartesian products of the fiber with itself, or the corresponding fiber of E1 at M and the corresponding fiber of E2 at M, and put them together. So the added advantage of this construction, or why we care about this construction, is that a bundle is actually more than just a collection of spaces. It comes with a manifold structure and this bundle projection, so this submersion P1 plus P2, right? And so the added benefit of all these constructions will be that the total space also carries a manifold structure, and we will be working later on with these manifold structure, because we want to describe smooth mappings into, for example, the Whitney sum, and or smooth mappings on the Whitney sum of two bundles. Okay. However, now we have everything set up to actually construct the manifold structure on our manifolds of mappings. So we can jump right at this. We now have the technology and language ready to formulate and to construct the manifold structure. Okay.